not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him.
Oh,
time as we sing together, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. So much has gone on in the last 200 years, and as we look around us today, there are still so much questions. But Father, as we are in your presence this morning, there is one thing that we are sure, and that is you alone are God. So Father, as we take this time this morning to celebrate and to focus on you, we ask that you would be among us. Father, that you would be praised. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask the children to come forward at this time. And if you consider yourself a child, come forward at this time. Come on down, brother. Come on. It's okay. He won't bite you, I promise.
Are you the only one, Alex? Come on down.
Come on, Alex.
Oh, man.
Levi's coming.
You can tell they're Baptist, you gotta yank them down.
Well, what we're going to do today is we're going to have a children's story, but I was thinking, what can we have a story on? And I'm sure you guys, you hear your parents talking, maybe you see it on the news, whatever. And what we need in this country more than anything in the world is a healthy dose of loving your neighbor, right? That's what God tells us to do. So we're going to look at the story of the Good Samaritan. And that's found in Luke chapter 10. And I'm simply going to read a verse, and then we're going to have the story, and we're going to look at it together. But a certain lawyer stood up, and tested Jesus, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said, "What is written in the law? And what is your reading of it?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." So that's what we're going to look at today. So, the first one is love. And the first thing it says we're to do is to love God. Can you guys tell me who else we're supposed to love? Okay, all your neighbors. So yeah, that God wants us to love all our neighbors. Anybody else think of someone we're supposed to love? Yes, God. Our neighbors and else. You're supposed to, you're supposed to love your brother and your sister. And God says that. That's right. You know. Very good, Alex. Alex, like that one. Anything else? How about? Yeah, our mothers and our dads, we're supposed to. Definitely, Alex says, and God says we're supposed to. So that's right. So those are great answers, and I really appreciate it. But now we're going to look at what Jesus said. We've got a story to go along with that. The story of the Good Samaritan. It says that there was a man that was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. And if you ever wondered what that meant, Jerusalem's up on a mountain. Jericho's down in the valley. So the man was walking down the road, and what happened? Thieves attacked him. Robbers attacked him. And I didn't wear my mask, but what do you see? They're wearing a mask. These are bad guys. But we know today that even good guys wear masks, right? But they attacked this man. They beat him up. I mean, they left him for dead. They robbed him, and they left him from dead at the side of the road. Now, there were some people that came by. If I get this in the right order. Oh, no. The first one that came by was a priest. Now, that's a priest at that time, but what would we say a priest is today? What else? Somebody that teaches about God. So what would
people on the side of the road.
Yeah, help people on the side of the road. And what would we call that person?
A preacher.
And you know what the preacher did? He went on the other side of the road and just walked right on by.
I
want to
help the poor man.
Well, he should have. But he didn't. He did not. The second person that came by was a Levite. Well, what would we call a Levite? Levite was a preacher's helper, so what would we call that today?
Assistant.
An assistant? Okay, we might also say a deacon. You know what the deacon did? On the other side of the road, walked on by, did not stop. And he should have stopped, right? He should have, absolutely, but he did not. I know. But now, in our story, who stopped was a Samaritan. Now, we need to talk about a Samaritan for a moment. The Samaritans lived north of the kingdom of Judah. They were the hated and despised by the Jews because they didn't worship God the same way. They had t- taken on foreign ways. And so they were like a different country. They were like from a different country. And they weren't like. But this Samaritan happened to be going by, and what did he do? He stopped. He bandaged the man. He gave him something to drink. He put him on his donkey, took him to an inn, and then he said, listen, this man is hurt. He can't go anywhere. I want to pay for him to stay here, and I'll stop back by in a week or so, and I'll pay you again if I owe any more. He took care of him. And Jesus said, of the three, the priest, the Levite, the Samaritan, which one was the neighbor?
The Samaritan.
The Samaritan. Why was he the neighbor?
Because he helped him.
Exactly. He showed with it. That's right. I know we don't have a microphone, and I apologize, but Alex just said with his passion, he showed that he loved God. That's what we need to do. Who are examples of neighbors that we can show that passion of loving God to? It could be anybody. Family? Absolutely. We a lot of people know us by how we act to our family. What else? Anyone else? Friends. Yes. So there's a lot of people that we can show love for. And that's what we want to do. And that's what Jesus said. Love your neighbor as yourself. Let's pray. Father, thank you for letting us look at your word. And Father, let us read and actually understand the story that Jesus told to illustrate your word. We are to love God with everything we have, and then we're to love our neighbors as ourselves. And if we have that passion, as Alex said, to serve God, then we are going to help our neighbors. And if we all love our neighbors as ourselves, oh my, what a world this would be. So I'm praying right now that Christians would do just that. That we would love our neighbors as ourselves. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before you guys go back, I've got a little booklet. It's got some coloring sheets and some word studies and some different things and kind of help you occupy the time we're going to be here today. Okay? Thank you very much for being here. You go back to your seat. Thank you. Give them a hand. To recognize some special folks. And you know, once you start doing that, you always leave someone out. So if I leave someone out, I apologize right up front. But as I was looking out over the congregation today, I thought these are some folks that I do want to mention. One of them is Andrew Bryant. Andrew was a former staff member here. And so we're so glad that he and his family are here. Glad to have you. Another visitor that we have today is Tim Batchelor. I believe I saw Tim.
Over here.
Tim, you're in the corner. Tim is our associational missionary for Kilpatrick Association. We're so glad to have you here with us today. I also saw John Prater and his family. John is a friend of the church. John is a representative of Gospel Link, and so we're just so glad that you could join with us today also. Then we have some other special guests today. We have representing Columbia County, we have Doug and Jean Duncan. Doug is he's the head of the county commission. And we have Dewey Galvis, and we're so glad to have you with us. And we also have Gary and Ginger Richardson with us. So they're representing Columbia County. And at this time, I think Doug had a proclamation he wanted to share with us. So Doug, please come on up and do that.
It is awkward.
Well, it is truly an honor to be here today to celebrate 200 years with you. Because when we see the things going on in our society, I mean, would you agree with me? The only solution is Jesus.
Amen.
And so what this church has done over the last 200 years is truly phenomenal. Find ways to again share like to read a proclamation from the Columbia County Commission in honor of the 200th anniversary of Damascus Baptist Church of Abilene, Georgia. Whereas on July 28, 1820, Damascus Baptist Church was organized and constituted by Samuel Bartlett and Wilder Hillman to serve the people of the Leah community and surrounding areas. And whereas Damascus Baptist Church began with the founding members of Jeremiah Blanchard, James Ramsey, Jeremiah Roberts, Sarah Blanchard, Sarah Reed, Nellie Swan, and Margaret Wilkins, and now leads multiple ministries and a growing congregation. And whereas for 200 years since the laying of the church foundation through Jesus Christ, the Damascus Baptist Church has sought to evangelize, disciple, minister, fellowship, and worship together as a community. And whereas Damascus Baptist Church has been in the past and continues to be one of God's vessels for sharing the gift of salvation and abundant life through Jesus Christ. And whereas on Sunday, July 19, 2020, the church will celebrate 200 years of God's faithfulness with homecoming event. Now therefore, we, the Columbia County Board of Commissioners, do hereby congratulate Damascus Baptist Church family on its 200th anniversary and recognize the valuable contribution the church has made for the welfare of individuals and families in this area. And we do express our desire for the continued success and fruitful ministries of Damascus Baptist Church. Signed and sealed this day. Columbia County Commission. Thank you very much.
But one of the things that I always enjoy is in his bio is that John has with him his wife, Claire. And Claire is the one who shared Jesus with you and won you to the Lord. And I think that is tremendous. So just, I like to share that. The only other thing I'll share about John is when I was a very young pastor and I was taking a lead like Jesus, I believe that was the course, and John was facilitating it. And as I was sitting there, John told me, "David, you don't have to wear a tie at every event." That stuck with me, so I wanted to. At this time, and John also is a. At this time is, well, you start with what he's done. When I first knew of John was the pastor of Curtis Baptist. He then went to work for the state in various different things. He's done interim pastors all over the state. And he is a good friend of Damascus Baptist Church. He lives just down the road on Ridge Road. And John also currently is working for the Baptist Foundation. And so, John, I think you had something to share with us at this time. From the Book Mission Board.
Thank you, Pastor. Apparently my leadership did not spill over to you. Your time looks great. We're here to celebrate, and there are so many factors in that celebration. Today I'm representing the Georgia Baptist Mission Board, for whom I served and with whom I served for 20 years. And on the behalf of our current executive director, Thomas Hammond, I'm wanting and liking and loving to present this as a tribute to your 200th anniversary. Let me read it, please. Congratulations to Damascus Baptist Church, Abilene, Georgia, on the happy occasion of its 200th anniversary, 1820 to 2020. Presented to Dr. David D. Stockton, Sunday, July 19, 2020, and signed by the Executive Director of the Georgia Baptist Mission Board, W. Thomas Hammond, Jr. Congratulations, Pastor and Church. You are truly a picture of faithfulness.
We have a very special guest with us today. Someone who grew up in the church, someone who's still part of the church, and of course that is Jackie Eubank Lay. She was a number of years a foreign missionary serving in Nigeria. And of course, as I said, she grew up in this church, in this community. She now resides in Texas, but we're so glad to have her with us today. And Jackie, we just want you to come up, if you would, at this time and share. And again, on your bio. Now, if I skipped anything that you think should be shared, please do. Okay.
Good morning, Damascus. I am just so delighted to be able to share with you some of my growing up years in the 1940s and the early 50s, long before most of you were ever thought about. As you can imagine, the physical building itself was totally different. There was no vestibule, shorter, no choir loft, no baptistry, just a little building on the back, no Sunday school rooms, no stained glass windows, no organ, no air conditioning and central heating. There was a little pot-bellied stove right over there, and we had fans in the summer, the kind that you use with your hands. Every Sunday, there was Sunday school in the afternoon, and training union, or BYPU, that night. On the second and the fourth Sundays, a pastor would come from Augusta, a preacher would come and preach after Sunday school. I was fortunate to have parents who made sure that every time there was something in the church, that I was there. And this included our revival that was always started on the fourth Sunday of July. Before the revival started, all the women of the church would come together on a specified day and clean the church till it was spotless. The men would come and clean the yards and clean the cemetery. And they would bring us children along, but how much we helped is very debatable, I'm sure. But that experience taught me to have an appreciation for the building in which God's church comes to worship. At the revival, or the protracted meeting, as it was often called, there was preaching every morning and every night. And we kids loved it because we would often go home with our friends and spend the afternoon. And I do believe that every woman in the church had their best meal of the year during the revival at lunchtime. Now, what I didn't enjoy, and my sisters, I verified it with those, was when we misbehaved in church. My daddy would, first of all, he always sat right where you're sitting. He would motion for us to get up from wherever we were and come. I tried to keep my eyes from meeting his, but when I did, I knew I had to obey. But if we would just happen to be in his range, he would reach over and pinch us. I hate to be pinched to this day. But I have learned how to behave in church. It was during the revival of my eighth year that I made the biggest decision of my life, and I came forward to ask Christ to come into my life. The next morning, I was baptized across the road and down the hill in the little baptismal pool. I remember that Mother made me wear a little outfit. It had a skirt, but it had shorts. And her reasoning was that when I went down in the water and my little skirt floated up, nobody would see my panties. Now that's what an eight-year-old would remember. But you know, that was the beginning of me learning modesty. Because the baptismal pool was only filled with water in the summer when we had revival, I didn't think you could be saved any other time of the year. for many years, and I remember the first person that came forward in about April, and I'm thinking, how can she do that? I found out. Thank God we can ask Him to come into our life at any time. Now, another big decision came as a result of a responsibility that I had at Damascus. During my senior year of high school, I gave a leader's talk at Training Union every Sunday night. And as I look back on it, I am thinking, what on earth did a 15-year-old have to say? But I was being trained, so I guess that was the point. My preparation for that responsibility was done, unfortunately, at the last minute on Sunday afternoons. But I went through three Sunday afternoons when I just was very troubled in my being. And I finally decided, kind of like Samuel, God's trying to speak to me. So I got down on my knees beside the bed and I said, okay, God, I'll do anything you want me to if you will just tell me what it is and give me peace. The peace came immediately, but it took until that summer before I knew exactly what God was saying. I was at Ridgecrest Baptist Assembly when I felt God calling me to full-time Christian vocational service, and which of course then, as he has said, led me to being appointed by the International Mission Board. When I returned from Ridgecrest, I came down over that first Sunday and to tell my pastor and my church of the decision that I had made. My church family at Damascus has always been so supportive of what God has asked me to do. So many of them prayed for me, and some of them told me they were praying every day for me. And you know, when I retired, I suddenly realized I was losing so much prayer support, and it scared me then. I thought, Lord, I need some other people to pray for me now. Another way that my Damascus family supported me big time was after I'd been appointed by the Light of Foreign Mission Board then. I had been going to school forever. I had no money. I had to buy furniture and appliances to take with me to Nigeria. And the people of Damascus and some from Kaogi gave me a check for $1,500. Which in 1968 was a lot of money. And a deacon in a church in Thompson, who owned a furniture store, allowed me to come and buy at cost. And do you know that I bought everything that I needed for with that $1,500? Not only did my church provide the opportunities to make two of the biggest decisions of my life, but it instilled in me an appreciation for God's Word. In junior Sunday school, I memorized the books of the Bible, and I can still rattle them off to this day, and I frequently do when I'm looking for one of those obscure minor prophets. I do it in my mind, though. When I'm looking up something. I was also expected to memorize scripture in the junior years. And because my Sunday school teacher, Edith Reese, was also my third and fourth grade teacher at school, I don't remember which scripture I learned at school and which scripture I learned at church. At that point in time, a teacher could have you memorize whole chapters of the Bible, and that was part of school. As an intermediate, I again learned scripture and participated in the sword drill, which, if you don't know what that is, was learning to look up scripture in competition with others. Damascus was also instrumental in introducing missions to me. I was in Sunbeams, which now is Mission Friends, and GA's. And my fondest memory of Sunbeams was after it was over, and Miss Georgia Story, who was our Sunbeam teacher, had a truck. She let us sit in the back of the truck, and she took us all home. And yes, it was legal for kids to be in the back of the truck at that time. But I just lived up the road, but the other person lived all the way down to the Game and Fish Club, out that far. So I got to ride all the way down the ridge and then back to my house. I don't remember much about missions that I was taught then, but something must have been sticking, because when I was 8, I was asked at school to write a poem about what I wanted to be when I grew up. And even at that time, I wrote that I wanted to be a missionary and sail across the sea. I only flew, but anyway, it came true in some ways. As a high school student, I watched familiar places fill up with water as Clark Hill Dam was built. Many of us had doubts about the future of Damascus as the community was growing smaller and the people whose houses were going to be underwater began to move out of the community. But in God's faithfulness, He began to bring people to the Lear community, and Damascus didn't die, but instead began to grow. I got to know some of those wonderful first people who moved into the community and become a part of this fellowship when I was still single and spent my furloughs with Mother and Daddy. A lesson that I learned as a member of Damascus that was wherever I went, I was to move my membership and become an active part of the church, and I always did. During those furloughs, I would move my membership back to Damascus until they finally said, quit moving your membership. We're going to put you on this roll permanently, because it's too difficult to get your letter from one of the churches in Nigeria. God has allowed me to be a member of some great churches, like I am at the present time. But I have always praised God for His faithfulness in allowing my roots to go deep at Damascus. I praise God not only for His faithfulness to me as I grew up in this church, but for His faithfulness for these 200 years as God has built and sustained His church, Damascus Baptist.
So one last thing to do. And would Julie Edwards please come forward? Challenges, and I mean, there have been a record number of them. Julie, we're so thankful that you have been the leader all the way through, and we have a small token to present to you.
Hymn festival, and we're actually going to trace the hymns from
from the 1800s to present. But today, as part of our celebration, we're going to sing a hymn writer that we have right here in our own church. And Susan DeFore, in 2001, wrote words that you will see on the screen behind me and also are in your program if you'd like to look. And 2 years ago, when we got ready to start this thing, this whole planning of this thing, I think it was Jane that came to me and said, Susan has a hymn. Would you try and find music for it? So let me just tell you that the next time Susan wants to write a hymn, she's going to have somebody else find the music, because she wrote it in a meter that was very hard to find a tune that would fit. I finally found one, and it's Heavenly Sunlight. And to give you an idea, it has to be in 9/8, which means there are 9 beats to the measure. Most songs have 4 beats to a measure. This one has 9. So we're going to learn that today. I'm going to teach you the chorus, and then we're going to sing it. But the tune is Heavenly Sunlight, which I'm sure most of you know that hymn. And so I'm going to teach you the chorus right now. If you'll, Dad, if you're going to put, yeah, we must reach. So it was really interesting because as somebody who did not grow up here in the area, I don't know exactly what the ridge was. And so I've talked to several people who grew up in this area, and they have told me all about that. If you don't know, find one of them, and they will be happy to tell you, like this Jackie would be more than happy to tell you. But the words are really very interesting, and I think very much fit this church and this area. And so I did have to narrow it down. I think she had, did you have 6 verses to this? I think about 6 verses to this. So I did narrow it down to 3. So I'm going to teach you the chorus right now.
We must reach beyond the bridge and begin to build a bridge for all the world to see the love of God in you and me.
Sing that with me.
We must reach.
As we seek to do your will, we must pray.
If you will take. Now, if we can just find out if Lloyd's got any talent. If you will take your order of worship, and if you will stand, and also on the screen behind me, you will find a responsive reading based on Psalm 117 and 118. You will join me as we read responsively. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Extol him, all you people.
For great is his love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever.
The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us.
You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Thank you.
looking at the theme of the anniversary 2 years ago. We kept coming back to the book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verses 22 and 23. Great is thy faithfulness, for thy mercies are new each morning. So we're going to sing today stanzas 1 and 3 of Great is thy faithfulness, and then stanzas 1 and 4 of How great thou art. So if you'll take your hymnal, or you can look on the screen behind me, stand as we sing, please.
Thank you.
that. So I'm going to give you another chance at the chorus to look like they're actually happy that one day you have the opportunity to be in heaven and proclaim to God how great He is.
Then sings my soul.
Said these words,
by inspiration of God's Spirit. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven, from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. Now hold on to your pew. Here we go. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There'll be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. And then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And no day will have its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. The glory and the honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Let's pause to pray. Father, I put my hand upon the written word from which I have read, and I pray the living word, whose name is Jesus Christ, the eternal word of God, that he would put his hand on our hearts and our minds, and that this day would be a celebration of what you have said heaven is all about, that is new. May we be renewed in Christ is our prayer, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. Won't you be seated, please? You know, if anybody's going to have a word today, it's not just coming from Washington, D.C. or Atlanta or from Duluth, where the ministry headquarters is for the Georgia Baptist Mission Board. If anybody's going to have a word for us today, it's going to be Jesus. And so here's what Jesus said years ago, and it is so relevant for us today, this 200th homecoming anniversary celebration. He said in John chapter 14, verse number 2, he said, in my Father's house are many rooms or mansions, and if it were not so, I would have told you, for I'm going there to prepare a place for you. So even though we don't know what tomorrow holds, even though we don't understand all that is within the school schedule, the sports schedule, whatever may be ahead that we've had as we call the normal schedule, God has a scheduled time for every one of us. And he promised that since he's gone to where the Father gave him to us, that is, that God sent his only Son to us, he said and he promised that there's a place for us. You say, well, that's good, preacher. I've heard that so many years. Well, that's good for us to hear again. Because even though we don't know what tomorrow brings, we know what yesterday brought to us in Jesus, and we know what we need to be doing today to glorify him and to honor him in every way possible. I love what the writer of Hebrews said in Hebrews 13:8. He said that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Now, in an ever-changing world, we are desperate for some sense of stability. Well, guess where he is? He's right here. He's celebrating with us. It's Jesus, and he's inviting us to not only say where we were born or even born again, but where we will be born for an eternity to be with the Father for every day and every year for the rest of our lives. I want to ask you a question. What's that heavenly home going to be like? What's it going to be like? Pastor, people have asked me throughout my years as a missionary and as a pastor, they said, can you just describe what heaven's going to be like so I can kind of get a feel for it? Well, biblically, of course, we know, those of us who've studied through the years, you know that it says that there will be streets of gold, okay? Whether they're physical streets of gold or not, I'm not going to debate God on that. There'll be gates like pearl and jasper, and there'll be these incredible expressions of the beauty that we mark here and now. But through the years, God has given me one solid response that we just read in these first five verses of Revelation 21. It's going to be a three-letter word. Here it is, not hard to remember, but something to look forward to. N-E-W. It's going to be new. say, well, I'm sick of new. We've had new all too long. You know, we got new schedules, we got new masks, we got new rules, we got new regulations, we got new prohibitions. Well, this kind of new is wonderfully new. And we need to get ready for it. As great as it is to celebrate every event, every birthday, every anniversary, every spiritual marker in our lives, the greatest thing that we can do is look forward to the newness of what God has for us. The scriptures teach us that our new home will be altogether different from the world in which we live. And I want to look at some of the differences as we examine it today. So I'm just going to pull from the Bible what you've heard before, but I want it to become a fresh new word for Damascus Baptist Church and for all of the churches that are represented here today. A fresh new word from God, reminding us that though you may not know what's here now, He's got something there that He's drawing us to for an eternity in the presence of Jesus Christ, our Lord. So let's begin. Let's dig in here. Here's what God is trying to say to us. First thing is this, and it's most confusing, I think, of all the passage here. And I want to just attempt to break it down a little bit to make it understandable for us. The scripture says, if you'll go back with me, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. And the first heaven and the first earth, I'm in verse number one, had passed away. And then he said, and there was no longer any sea. He said, well, wait. Didn't he know that three quarters of our globe is made up of water, oceans, lakes, ponds? I mean, here we are just 1 mile away from the largest body of water in all of Georgia. And you say, well, there's not going to be any more lakes? You know, there's not going to be any more ocean? What does he mean by that? Well, the sea is filled with several things. First of all, it's a mystery. It's a mystery in some ways because we don't know everything that's underneath the sea, do we? There are more fish and species of animals that have yet to be named under the oceans and in the seas than there are which we have categorized and put together. So the sea represents mystery. Does not life represent mystery? Like, we don't get everything that's going on. We want the answers, we want the conclusions, we want the depth of understanding, but God is saying to us, there's going to be clarity in heaven. We're going to get it. Paul wrote to the church in Corinth. He said these words. He said, now we see as through a mirror dimly, or almost like a fog. But he said, then someday, there'll be a clearing of that, and we'll see Christ face to face. You say, well, that's scary. No, it's not. The mystery will be gone, and the presence and the power of the relationship will be real and will be lasting for each and every one of us. But also, if you've been down to the seacoast recently or even in times past, because not many of us are taking the vacation much anymore, we're all cautious as we should be. But sea represents also turmoil. Because, as you know, the moon draws in the waves, and the waves create the shoreline that gets beaten upon as the waves come in, and as we continue to see the tide go out and come in, it's a turmoil. That's why they have walls. That's why they have the big sea walls that protect the shorelines. Is life a turmoil for you right now? Is everything maybe upside down? Have you been furloughed? Have you been maybe laid off? Have your hours been cut back? Has it been a problem, perhaps, not only understanding what tomorrow holds, but even being able to feel the stability of what today is presented? God said there'll be no more turmoil. It won't be that you're like when you're out in the ocean. You feel like you're in a calm, and all of a sudden an undertow takes you out, or a big wave takes you in, and you are doing nothing but scrambling. When you wanted to be on top of the wave, you're in the middle of the wave, and it's just nothing more than just a tumultuous expression. But you know what? Isaiah the prophet said these words. Listen to them carefully from Isaiah 57, verses 20 and 21. He said, the wicked are like the troubled sea. When it cannot, there is no peace, says my God, to the wicked. We live in a land that is not filled with peace. We have civil unrest. We have difficulties going on. We don't know exactly what these next few months are going to hold, but we do know that we're held by Him. And we do know that there is a force that is against those who stand for the rightness of God and the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So we're not in a battle against our government. We're not in a battle against people who are not like us or who we don't like. We're in a spiritual battle right now. And we're in a battle against the spiritual forces that would be classified, as Isaiah said, as wicked. And so you say, well, okay, those are the bad guys, and I'm part of the good guy team. I'm going to be okay. Well, in the midst of the battle, there's always a wound. And many of us have been wounded. But we are not to give up. You know what I think John was talking about in a deeper sense about the sea? When he said there's no longer any sea? John was a pastor. He founded churches. And as the Apostle John had founded the church at Ephesus, where he was exiled because of his faith, because of his faithfulness, he was placed on a little island called Patmos. That's where God gave him his vision. And when God gave him the vision at the island of Patmos, I can only imagine that he was doing what any pastor and any person who loved their church family would be doing. They'd be looking and longing to be placed back where they loved the people and the people loved him. So he's looking across the sea. He's in an island, on an island, and he's looking toward Ephesus, and he's thinking in terms of, I'm separated from them now. Haven't we been separated from the people who we love? Of course we have. A father, a mother, a brother, a sister, a son, a daughter, an uncle, an aunt. The 200 years of heritage that Damascus has held from the time when the first pastor stood and preached and stayed for 19 years. Now that's a good tenure, isn't it? Don't you agree? 19 years teaching and preaching. Redeemed and changed, as I know, you've read the historical sign as I have, you've done your homework, you know the church better than I do. One whose life was changed in the midst of arresting a man of God and a godly wife, I can identify with that. A godly wife who stands on the behalf of her husband and teaches and preaches, and suddenly the arresting officer who becomes the first pastor of the church hears the word of God through a godly wife, and his life is changed. He's baptized. He becomes a deacon, and then he becomes the pastor of the church. You talk about a changed life. That's a changed life. He loved this church in the beginning. The separation and the pain that we feel oftentimes goes deep in our lives, and we long for there to be a reunion. Well, guess what, folks? It's good to see you, and you are good and glad to see people you haven't seen in a while. But someday, God is going to put us together again with those who said yes to Jesus. The graveyard is filled with those who said yes to Christ. Our hearts will long to be with those who we've loved in times past and who we will be able to love again for eternity as God places us together with Him. So a good word from what God was saying through John is that there'll be no more mystery, no more turmoil, no more separation. But you know, let me just share with you. There's another feature as we go a little bit deeper into the Word of God here. So follow along with me. Look at verse number 4 if you have that, and I'll make it a little more clear by rereading. Tear from their eyes. Nothing's wrong with crying. Songs have been out for years. Big boys don't cry. Well, okay, this big boy does. Jesus cried. He wept over a city that was lost and undone. He wept over the death of a friend named Lazarus. He wept. God is not condemning tears. He is expressing through the Apostle John and to us by the Holy Spirit that there is a time of comfort that will come like we've never experienced before. Can you imagine God wiping away your tears? Well, that's wonderful. I mean, handkerchiefs and Kleenexes and what we carry with us, they're okay, but they're not like the hand of God coming down and taking us into a new period and into a new expression of love and care and comfort that only God could bring. So He will take our tears from us. And that is a beautiful and marvelous expression. And as our Christ wept, so we weep too, and we should weep over our nation, over our county, over our state, over our families.
because God is wanting us to be as one with Him. He's got to prepare a place for us. So why would we turn Him down on the greatest invitation of all? But there's a third feature. Keep digging a little bit deeper in your scripture here. And I look to it as I dig into the latter portion of verse number 4. Not only will it wipe our tears away, there'll be no more death or mourning or crying. On several occasions, I stop by the cemetery because I just live down the road. And I'll come through the gates and I'll walk up and down the rows between the grave markers. And I'll read the tombstones. Because they represent not only the families that are represented here, but the families that became the foundation piece of faithfulness for the church. And I think in terms of the hurt and the anguish that death brings into any and every one of our lives, because we don't want to lose something that we love and someone who we love. But as you walk up and down the rows, know that they are not there. They're not there. They have gone home. They've gone home. The memories are rich and lingering, and sometimes they're painful. But they are not there, and we will not remain here as well. There'll be a time when there will be no more funeral home processions. There'll be a time when there will not need to be florists who will put together bouquets and wreaths on front doors for grieving families. There'll be a time when death will be no longer. There'll be a time when the county coroner will be out of business because there's not going to be anybody to declare as departed from this earth. I am so grateful for that. And no more mourning or crying. No more of the depth of the pain that every one of us feels. God is a healer. And God's ultimate healing begins here. And then it culminates in the place that really, really is the greatest homecoming of all. And He takes us to be with Himself. But let's go a little bit deeper into this, okay? Stay with verse number 4 with me just for a moment, and I want to share some things with you. Scripture goes on and it says something that every one of us can identify with, and that is that there'll be no more pain. No more pain. Well, Romans 5:12 states it this way, Therefore, just as sin entered into the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all men because all have sinned. We all will die physically. We know that. We all will be in pain here where God has us, but we all have an opportunity for a glorious, heavenly, great physician to touch us and to bring us into a new sphere of spiritual development. And His name is Jesus. No more pain. Well, if you're a pharmacist, I'm sorry, you're out of business. You can't fill my prescription anymore. No CVS's in heaven. No more Walgreens, no more physician scripts that they can barely read because the physicians will not be able to write a prescription to hand to the pharmacist or send via email. All of that's going to be gone. The kind of pain that you and I have is multiple, isn't it? The pain that is on the inside of us emotionally, the pain that is mentally ours because we cannot tell what day it is and we don't even know why all of this is going on. But then there's a physical pain that's in our life as well, whether we get it by aging or whether we get it by accident. There's somebody that's carrying a lot of pain. And in that, there's hope. There's great hope. God has given me an opportunity, as I'm also pastoring it at a church in South Augusta right now, helping Hillcrest Baptist, who has no pastor. And I've learned to wear a variety of masks. I'm looking for where I put it there, Brother David. Anyway, you'll have to believe me if I can't find it by dipping into my pockets here and seeing where it is. Oh, yeah, there it is. Okay. So the first day that we met together 5 weeks ago as a congregation, I stood up there and I said, we are here to celebrate hope.
Because, as you see with my mask, hope has not been canceled.
Thing. It's just a real thing. The hope that God gives us in Him is a lasting hope. It's not a temporary hope, and it's not a gag, and it's not something that brings us a good feeling. But you see, when God takes away the pain, He replaces it with hope. and with security and with peace and with a power that you and I cannot get on our own. But we got to go a little bit deeper here. We're almost there. The finish line is within view, okay? So hang on, hold on. Let's go to verse number 25, okay? You're in Revelation 21. Let me take you to verse number 25 there, and let me read it aloud for you as we look at it again. At that scripture, we discover that on no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. There'll be no night there. Well, that's good news, isn't it? There'll be no night. What does that mean? That means we're going to stay awake all day long. It's going to be like Alaska. You never know when there really is a night or not, because the sun never sets. No. What does night represent here? Night represents fear, because we're not comfortable with the dark. We're not comfortable when we cannot see what's ahead of us. No night means no fear. So I wonder, what are you afraid of? Are there things in your life that you are dealing with right now? I know there are. They're all about us. And the word literally means here, nothing, as he said, nothing impure means there'll be no sin there. No night, in other words, no fear and no sin. You say, well, okay, so people are not going to double cross me. They're not going to lie to me. They're not going to send ugly texts about me or say something on Facebook that's not true. That's right. Because there's no sin there. That's a beautiful thing. What are you afraid of? What are you afraid of? There's so many things in our life that we could say. Crime, health, friends, family. What could it be? Could it be just the impending, looming, dooming expression of a virus that has no clear vaccine at this time? Look, we all have our fears. That's human. But what becomes divine is God's cure for all of that, because he's expressing to us that there is something that we can have that we don't ever earn, that only God can give us, that only God can bring to us. Because when there's no sin there, there's nothing to fear. God has given to us something that is no longer a curse. In fact, if you looked on in chapter 22 of the Revelation and you looked at that and you looked at verse number 3, you'll see kind of a culmination of what I'm saying as we express it. And as John saw it and as he was trying to say it, he was saying that there'll be no longer any curse. No curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and the servants will serve him. Well, isn't that wonderful? Guess where the practice field is? It's here. So if we're not doing a good job of serving Christ here, it's going to be miserable there, because there will be a joy that we'll have. As Keith has reminded us, the joy that's on our face is one part of it, but the joy that's in our heart is a lingering part of it. And God will give us the opportunity to serve him as never before. So folks, let's practice now. Let's get ready. Let's celebrate, yes, the anniversaries and the homecomings and the joy of a foundation that is a solid rock of Jesus Christ in what God has chosen to do through Damascus Baptist. But then let's go deeper into the solid rock of Christ our Lord. And let us stand upon his faithfulness to us and what he has chosen to give to us. So let me go back to the first question. Where's your home? Is it Atlanta? Is it Augusta? Is it Evans? Is it Martinez? Though that's relevant to answer today, tomorrow it will be irrelevant, because our true homecoming, the greatest homecoming, is what Jesus is offering to every one of us now. And he said it simply. He said, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. Us. He said, I'll give you rest. Well, I want to rest in him. And the rest that he gives is not just a ticket to heaven, but it is the peace and the joy and the love and the appreciation for the life that God has given to each of us and what he's preparing for us someday. So I want to ask some questions out loud, because I'm asking them of myself first and foremost. But hear me well and answer them for yourself before God. Are you certain of your heavenly home? Do you really, really, really know? He said, well, I hope so. I was baptized years ago. I became a part of a church. I've been fairly faithful. I give. I try. I do everything I can. Well, quit doing and start being. Because in him, as a member of his family, you can know that you know that you know that Jesus Christ has a home for you. Are you certain of it? Number two, is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? That's a biblical, theological expression. What in the world is a Lamb's Book of Life? Well, it's simply put, as you registered coming in the door, saying, I've come to Damascus's 200th anniversary, you wrote your name, you wrote your address, you said, I'm here. Well, the Lamb's Book of Life is where God has written your name, and he's put it into a place where you know, and where all can know that there is a heavenly home for you. His book will never be erased. It'll never be lost. It'll never grow old. The third and final question is this. Will you let this homecoming here in Damascus prepare you? Prepare you and maybe open the door for the greatest homecoming of all. Because Jesus is inviting every one of us to come to him. If you've never met Christ as your Savior, that's why you're here today. Because he's opened the door for you. And it may be that you are a part of the church and no longer a part of the church, or maybe a guest. Doesn't matter. When you come to Christ, you don't come to a pastor and you don't come to a church. You come to Christ and you come to Jesus. And he's inviting us to do that today. So if you've never met him today, the pastor of this church, the shepherd of this church, the one who cares and longs and loves to help you to know who Jesus is, He will be standing here to receive you. Maybe it's been a while and you thought, well, I think I'll plug into another church. But you know, really, this is my home. This is where I really belong here at Damascus Baptist. Well, come home. Come and join the family of God here. Come and join the fellowship of those who want to reach and touch and celebrate Christ in this community and beyond. Maybe, like me, you may want to spend a moment at this altar and just pray, thanking God that he's prepared a place for us, and thanking him that he, in the midst of the turmoil and the mystery and the pain of the separation that we may have, he is our answer. Let's stand and pray. Would you join me? Father, we are so grateful for your faithfulness. In the midst of our unfaithful lives, and that represents each of us, we wander so easily, and we get off track, and we get detoured, we get discouraged, and we even become depressed. But God, I want to thank you today for the reminder that you gave to the Apostle John years ago that we can just examine once more, and now to respond to you. God, this is a time of dedication. Rededicating the church to Jesus Christ, rededicating the faithfulness of God's people at Damascus, but also it's a time of personal dedication. Coming to meet Christ, coming back to him, coming to join his family. Lord, would you impress upon every heart that is here today what needs to be done? Would you bend the knees that need to bend? Would you break the hearts that need to be broken? Would you repair the wounds that hurt? Healing. All of this we ask and we trust through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our hymn of dedication is Miss Blake Keith will lead us in. There is a land that is fairer than day. That's the land where he's taken us. Can't buy much land around here very cheap, but what you can do is you can take the grace of God and you can go to the place that he'll give you. And you don't have to sign a deed at all. He's already prepared a place, and he's waiting for you. Pastor, please, receive those who come, others who need to come forward to pray, to rededicate their hearts, their lives, their service for Christ. This is the day the Lord has made. We rejoice in it, and we're glad.
The land that is fairer than day.
celebrating 200 years of Damascus Baptist Church. We're going to leave here in just a moment, and I'm sure you will want to visit. We have decided visiting would probably be better having the parking lot than the air. However, if you want to put on your mask and go into our welcome center, we have lots of historical committee has laid out documents, pictures, things of interest that if you're tied to this church, your family's tied to it. We welcome you to do that. Again, we thank you. Oh, and there are tours of the baptismal pool. And that's going to start in the Welcome Center, or start out here. Start on the front porch this week. Tours of the baptismal center. So we do have some things going on, and we encourage you to participate. Thank you for coming.
You will join me as we say together Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine upon us, that your ways may be known upon the earth, your salvation among all nations.